Once again, thank you for joining the webinar. Dr. Jean-François Bottelier de Poix, who is the speaker of today, has a PhD in nuclear physics. He is working at RSN, the Institute for Radiological Protection and Nuclear Safety, since 1992 in the field of radiation protection. He was the head of the external dosimetry department during 12 years, which is in charge of all the research and expertise of everything concerning radiation protection, so industry, medicine, aeronautics, space, which is also one of his passions, is dosimetry in space. And since 5 years now, he's deputy director of radiological protection and health at RSN. Jean-François is also the member of various organizations like ISO, ICRU, ICRP, EURADOS, and all his interests are in dosimetry in complex fields and dose assessment in case of radiological accident.
Thank you, Vincent, for this kind, this kind of introduction. So the objective today is to show you what is the challenge and what is the objective of dosimetry of cosmic radiation. I will focus on things dealing with radiation protection regarding human beings only. I will not talk about the effect on components. So I propose the following content. First, the first part will be dedicated to the characteristic of cosmic radiation. The second one on dosimetry in aviation. The third one in space, because it's two different approach. In particular, because the characteristics of the cosmic radiation is different. And finally, a conclusion. So regarding the characteristics of cosmic radiation, the origin, there are different components. The first one is from galactic or extragalactic origin. So we'll see later what are the kind of particles and their energy. And the second part is coming from the sun, is from solar origin. And we will see that the sun activity has an impact on the cosmic radiation reaching the Earth. Here you have a figure representing the different kind of ions. So the cosmic radiation we are talking about is mainly, it's in the field of ionizing radiation. So we focus only on cosmic radiation composed with the ions. So we have the most important contribution is from hydrogen. And then we have charged particle ions up to Z up to more than 20. So carbon, nickel, oxygen. Well, and the abundance of the higher Z particles is obviously lower. And if we look at the red bar, it's weighted by the square of the atomic number, so it's more to give an idea on the impact on the dose. But in any case, the most important particle and ion is hydrogen. So this primary cosmic radiation interact with the atmosphere. The atmosphere, the top of the atmosphere is considered to be at around 35 kilometers. So as cosmic radiation is very high energy particles, so you have interaction with the showers and providing a lot of secondaries like pions, neutrons, protons, muons, well, a lot of secondaries. So you have, we will see later, on this slide, we have a build-up effect when particle penetrating the atmosphere, and with a maximum at around between 20 and 25 kilometers in altitude. So here you can see the ambient dose equivalent as a function of altitude, so from the ground up to 25 kilometers. So here you can see the maximum here, somewhere here. So you can see the total ambient dose equivalent, and you can see the different contribution of the different particles. So if we look at, we will see it more in details later, but if we look at the flight altitudes between 10, 15 kilometers, the major contribution is from neutrons, which are in fact secondary. They are produced by interaction of the primary cosmic radiation ions. In practice, it's ions, and as they are very high energy, you have nuclear interaction. It's why you have such a variety of particles created in. And such a variety in secondaries. Another protection when we are on Earth is the magnetic field. So here you can see what we call the magnetosphere, and in yellow you can see the magnetic lines. You imagine the solar winds or the cosmic ray particles interacting. There is a pressure here, and here you can see it's a dipole, so the charged particles are entering more easily on the north or in the south, and close to the Earth you can see what we call here a kind of ring. This is what we call Van Allen belts, or radiation belts. So we will see that, for example, at the ISS level, we are just in the lower part of this Van Allen belt, and in which there is a concentration of protons and sometimes of electrons. Here, it's representing what we call the geomagnetic cutoff rigidity. It's representing the ability of charged particles to penetrate the Earth depending on the latitude. For example, the higher is the cutoff rigidity, higher is the protection. So that means, for example, here you will need high energy protons, at least more than, for example, 17 MeV to penetrate at the equatorial region here, and it's more easier at high latitudes. And this line here you can see the geographical position of the magnetic pole here, north and south here. Here it's an idea of the energy spectrum of the different components. For example, the solar wind in the lowest energy in comparison with the galactic part, and you have a large energy range from few hundreds of keV up to more than 10 to the 4 MeV, and here the maximum energy observed, it's a proton with an energy up to 10 to the 14 MeV, that means 10 to 20 EV, with a very low flux which is estimated at one particles per kilometer square per century. But you can see again that we have a very wide energy range. The lowest part is mainly regarding the particle of solar origin, and the highest part here, you can see the most energetic particles is from galactic origin. Here, it's an example of the Newton spectrum at the flight altitude. Here, it's a calculation. It's from Schraub and Howell. Here, it's a calculation at about 10, between 10 and 15 kilometers. And you can see the energy range here. So we, in this case, we have Newtons up to a few hundreds MeV. So that means we will need specific facilities, specific devices to measure such neutrons with such a wide energy range. Another important parameter is the solar activity. So the upper part is the, what we call the sunspot index. It's representing directly the solar activity. And the lower figure is representing what is reaching the Earth. Here it's it's measurements made by neutron monitor stations, which are located at the ground level. And as you can see, you have an opposition between when the solar activity is at the maximum, the particle reaching the Earth is at the minimum. So this apparent opposition is due to the fact that when the solar activity is increasing, the interplanetary magnetic field is reinforced and better is the protection from cosmic radiation of galactic origin. And at the Earth level, only and mainly the cosmic radiation from galactic origin is reaching the Earth surface. So it's why we have such a situation when the solar activity is max, the cosmic radiation entering the atmosphere in the ground level is at the minimum. This figure is showing the sun as a cycle with an average period of 11 years. You can see it here. And in the lower part, you can see the number of what we call GLE, like ground level events. It's in practice solar eruption, which are sufficiently energetic and with a high intensity to reach the ground, because most of the solar eruption, if they are not energetic and not very intense, they are stopped in the atmosphere. So here you can see the frequency, the number of GLEs since the middle of the last century, and you can see in red the GLE providing an increase at the Newton monitor level higher than 17%. And okay, so you can see that the maximum number of solar eruption is occurring during the solar maximum activity. It is an example. We can measure such events, such solar eruption at the ground with the ground Newton monitors, but we can also measure the proton, for example, the proton flux on the GOES satellite. Here you can see a measurements and over the GOES proton satellite, which is a geostationary satellite, and it's the proton flux, and you can see the different energy components. So the typical delay to reach the maximum is 1 hour when you have a solar eruption to reach the maximum. And you may have different eruptions. This one is quite complex because you have a first one eruption, you have a second one, and then it took hours and days for the decreasing phase. Here it's an example of a GLE 69, occurred on in January 2005, and it's an example of what is measured by Newton monitors at the ground level. So you have a framework of Newton monitor all over the world, and here you can see, for example, the Oulu station in red, the Kiel in Germany in blue. Okay, so in this case, it was a quite important GLE. Okay, so now we move on what is more specific, dosimetry more specifically in aviation. So the context and the challenge in aviation is that the exposure at aviation altitude is mainly due to galactic cosmic rays secondaries. The solar particle events contribute very sporadically to the exposure on board aircraft. It's what we call a GLE, when the solar particle event reach the aviation altitude. So for example, since the since 20 years, there were 4 GLEs which were significant with a visible effect at the flight altitudes. the occupational exposure for aircraft crews is assessed using models. We will see later that we may use models because the interaction and the we can take into account the solar activity. We can use parameters that allow to define models which are quite suitable and which are well validated. We will see later that we have a great confidence in models for galactic cosmic part. So for aviation, the measurements are needed mainly for validation of models, and in particular for GLEs, because as GLEs are events occurring not very often, we have very few measurements for validations. And when measurements are needed, specific approaches are defined for characterization and calibration of instruments. Just regarding the context, the context in terms of radiation protection, if we compare the exposure on board the aircraft, for example, it's a statistic in France, but it can be easily generalized. Here you have the staff exposed to artificial sources in different sector of activities, medical, nuclear, industry, research. And here we have the staff in aviation. So we can see that the staff in aviation is regarding 10% of the total staff exposed to ionizing radiation. And if we look at the total dose, the dose in terms of man sievert, they represent roughly 40%. So that means the mean dose received by crew members is higher than the mean dose received in other sector of activities using ionizing radiation. For example, in France, it's close to 2 millisievert per year, but it's a number which is quite similar in other countries. Just to have this graph gives an idea about the dose rate increase when at altitude, for example, at the sea level, the typical dose rate due to cosmic radiation is a few tenths of nanosievert per hour, and at the flight altitude, subsonic altitudes around 10 kilometers, it depends. Obviously, we will see later on latitude, but the typical dose rate is 5 microsievert per hour, and it's increasing, for example, for supersonic flight at 15 kilometers. And on Earth, we can reach in mountains more than a few microsievert per hour, more than 5. For example, at the Himalayan peaks, it could be more than 5. This graph represents the ambient dose equivalent rate in microsievert per hour as a function of altitude. So we start from 4 kilometers up to 15, and for low and high latitudes, and for solar activity minimum and maximum. So in the red, it's low. It's low latitude, so it's close to the equator. So we can see that the increase, we may have dose rate up to a few, 2 or 3 microsievert per hour. And the difference between high and low solar activity is quite small. At high latitude, it's a little bit different. First, the increase as a function of altitude is higher. You reach more than 5 microsievert per hour. It could be up it could be just below 15 at 15 kilometers. And the difference between low and high solar activity is more important. You can double the dose, for example, at minimum solar activity here. Now, if we look at the contribution of the different components, you remember it's we have a mixed field at the in the atmosphere created by the primary cosmic radiation, and for example at flight altitudes close to half of the contribution to the dose equivalent is coming from neutrons, the other part from electrons. And you see, even if the protons are the most important part at the entrance of the atmosphere, at the altitude flight altitude, it's lower. Here, it's a graph representing the different contribution to the dose equivalent to the effective dose for different flights, covering all the latitude and longitude. So, well, more or less, the contribution of the different components is quite stable, even if you have some variations. And here you can see, well, you can see that again, neutrons is contributing to about 40%. And these calculations were made with the former weighting factors. With the new ACP weighting factors, the weighting factor for protons are lower, so that means that relatively the contribution of neutrons are close to the to 50%. Here it's measurements made on board typical flights, and it is in the cycle. You have the dose equivalent integrating all during the flight. So you can see that, for example, for transatlantic or high latitude flights, the dose for a round trip, for example, from Paris to Tokyo is 150 microsieverts. And in comparison with the flight with the same parameters from Paris to Buenos Aires, it's it's 30% lower in comparison, and it's because it is at low latitude. And we have another interesting measurements. If you compare, for example, the dose for a round trip to Washington and New York, but New York with Concorde, we have more or less the same dose, even if the flight with Concorde is 3-4 hours in comparison with the Washington and with the classical subsonic flight, which is around 8 hours. And there is a compensation of the shorter is a flight with a supersonic aircraft, but higher in the altitude. So it's why, well, we have, as a result, a dose which is more or less equivalent. In the field of Eurados, it's a Eurados dosimetry group. It's a European group on dosimetry, and we have made a lot of comparison of models, benchmarking of models, comparison of measurements. So here it's a graph representing a comparison of measurements made with different various systems. It's mainly TPEX, but we have also silicon spectrometers. We have here you can see the comparison of the dose, ambient dose equivalent rate as a function of the cutoff rigidity. So it's strongly correlated to the latitude, and it's at an altitude of flight level of it's for an altitude of more or less 11 kilometers. So you can see that the agreement between measurements is quite good, and the deviation is within 15-20%. So it's quite satisfactory regarding the complexity of the field. It's another example on a single flight where we compare calculations made with a Sievert system. It's a system we use in France, but it is based on the EPCARD model developed by the German team at the Helmholtz Center. And you can see that the agreement is quite good. If you look at here, the integrated dose all over the flight, we have 120 microsieverts with measurements, and 120 26 with calculation. So it's a very good agreement. It's not always so good. We have also in the frame of the Eurados activities, we have made benchmarking with different models. So here you can see, for example, the dose integrated during various flights. So here you have different flights which are represented on this map. And you can see that, again, the agreement between the different models is quite satisfactory regarding radiation protection. So again, the deviation is around 15-20%. So it's fully satisfactory for the for radiation purposes. Here it's an interesting example. It's a calculation in case of a GLE. So the most important one since 20 years, it's a GLE occurred in January 2005. And here you can see the relative contribution to the dose. In blue, the surface below the blue line is the contribution of the galactic part. So it's about 80 microsievert, and in this case the dose during a flight, so it's for a flight between Paris and US, the east coast of US, and you can see in this case that the excess of dose due to the GLE is about twice the dose due to the galactic part. And here below, we have only very few measurements made at flight altitudes during a GLE. So we have compared the calculation with the measurements for GLE 60. Occurred in 2001, and here again you can see quite good agreement. So the GLE, the solar eruption, start here. You can see the increase and the decreasing phase here, and you can see a quite good agreement. And for to assess the dose in case of GLE, we have developed we are using, for example, here the Siegel model developed by the Paris-Meudon Observatory, and you can see the year the dose map for the GLE occurred in 2005. So the effect of this GLE is very low at low latitude, close to the equator. It's an increase of dose of 2 microsievert per hour, but the increase at high latitude can be very important. So how to characterize and calibrate systems? So as already said, the main contribution to the radiation at deviation altitude are neutrons, from a few hundred keV up to a few GeV, protons, again, few MeV up to few GeV, electrons, positrons, and photons in the same range. So the ISO reference radiation do not fully the ISO reference for calibration to define reference field is not covering fully the energy range for photons, neutrons, and electrons. So that means additional calibration fields are needed. And including for some devices, specific fields like high energy protons. And in this case, non-ISO fields can be used with a traceable technique to measure the particle fluents and convert it into ambience dose equivalent by applying fluence to dose conversion factors, the appropriate ones. And for example, as an example, for It's a field which are recommended in the ISO 27785 series, and it's a series providing recommendation to characterize the system used for dosimetry on border craft, and recommendation also to do measurements. So regarding neutrons, well, we can use radionuclide sources and also mono energetic neutron fields with energy lower than 20 MeV. So it's covered by this ISO series. For high energy neutrons, higher than 20 MeV, there is no ISO standards. So that in this case, various facilities can be used, providing energies up to a few hundreds MeV, like UCL in Belgium, ITEMBA labs in South Africa, TLCL, Kiara. Well, you have here the most important one. For charged particles, there are about more than 20 facilities worldwide providing protons and the heavy particles of up to few GeV. So again, the challenge in this case is to well characterize the field, the beam to be used for calibration or instrument characterization. We can also use a simulated workplace field. For the most famous one is the CERF facility, which is at CERN in Geneva. And the fields are created by high energy protons and pions, with two energies, 220 and close to 200 GeV, on a copper target and surrounded by iron or concrete shieldings, and simulating the atmosphere, and in this case, 80 centimeters of concrete is simulating a field that we have at 10-15 kilometers altitude. And we use also natural field. It's typically stationed on mountains where fields are characterized and could be used for benchmarking, for intercomparison. And you have here an example. And an example of systems which can be used to characterize, for example, the neutron component in such site, it's a Bonnell sphere system. In this example, it's a system developed by my colleague at IRSN, and it's a Bonnell sphere system with 11 spheres with polyethylene and three additional ones with a metal shell to take into account the high energy part. So it could be used for neutrons with an energy lower than 20 MeV up to a GeV. And the application is for high energy facilities like synchrotrons providing protons, for example. And it could be used also for cosmic neutron characterization at altitude. So, as I said, a specific standard have been developed by ISO. It's the 27785 series, and there are four parts providing recommendation for measurements on board aircraft. And the characterization of instruments. As an example, it's a practical application. It's regarding the calibration and monitoring of radiation on board aircraft. We set up such a monitoring in France with Air France, and we are dosimeters flying on more than 30 aircraft. And with the objective to get measurements in case of GLE, in case of JLEAP, because as I said, we have very few measurements. And such data could be used and will be very helpful for validation of the GLE models. So the main challenge in practice is to set up dosimeter on a large number of aircraft, to perform continuous measurements, to select what cheap dosimeter because and easy to operate dosimeters. We have to define a specific calibration because it's dosimeters which were not designed initially for measurements of cosmic radiation. We have to operate dosimeters. That means we have to organize the data collection, well, the battery change, and we have to provide information in case of GLE in a short time. So for this, regarding the calibration part, we organize what we call onboard calibration during dedicated flight. So for this, we use, for example, a TPC. A TPC is a system doing measurements, able to do measurements in complex field like those on board aircraft, and such an instrument is used to define what we call the reference value. And in such flight, we put together different dosimeter. It could be a very simple dosimeter like EPDN, for example. You have an example of what the EPD we use. The electronic non-personal dosimeter. We can use also here a silicon spectrometer, and we define correction factors, calibration of correction factors. And for example, here we have made different flights. It's from Paris to San Francisco and from Paris to Japan, and we have defined a correction factor for the low LET part and the high LET part. So one can see that it's quite homogeneous if you look at the average. So that means we can define the global correction factor for all the flights and for different latitude and altitudes. And we have also see a comparison of the correction factor and the calibration factor which was defined for this silicon detect spectrometer at the CERF facility at CERN, and the correction factor the calibration factor we have obtained during the flight. So one can see that it's quite close. Okay. So that's all for the dosimetry at aviation. Now dosimetry in space. In space, well, the context and the challenge is a little bit different. So the protection, because the protection is lower and the exposure is higher than on Earth, because, for example, on board ISS, there is no atmosphere, but we have still the magnetic field. On the moon, we have no magnetic field and no atmosphere. And on Mars, we have no magnetic field, but we have a thin atmosphere. And here you have, the thickness is about 20 grams per centimeter square on Mars, and in comparison to 1,000 on Earth. The effect of solar SP may be very important, but is all the more attenuated as the protection is important. What I mean that, well, we have no protection coming from the atmosphere, and which may be very different depending on the situation. It depends if you are in the free field in space, if you are in a space ship. It depends if you are on the moon or on Mars. It depends on the building. Well, and the dosimetry Well, the dosimetry is made by measurements and no models. It's one of the biggest difference between the approach for aviation and space. We have no models because we have a very heterogeneous situation in space. So the occupational exposure for space crew can be made with personal dosimeters, where it can be made very simply with passive systems. And what is important is area monitoring outside or inside the spacecraft or building. And here, the measurements of particles, fluences, and microdosimetry absorbed dose can be made using detectors using different assemblies of various size. So do measurements with respect to time, LET, energy, as appropriate. So the approach is completely different. Here it's an example of the exposure in space regarding the galactic component. If we compare, for example, here the ambient dose rate per day in millisievert per day, we have a very big differences between depending on the situation. So on Earth, as expected, we have a good protection providing by the atmosphere and the magnetic field. So it's the dose rate is about 1 microsievert per day. In comparison with ISS, the International Space Station, or during the travel in a space craft on at the mass surface. So you can see here that the most important part, the most important dose received is during travel, because we have no protection providing by the, for example, on Mars by the because we are on Mars, so Mars is hiding and is stopping. If we consider that the cosmic radiation is isotrope, the fact that we are on the surface is stopping more or less half of the flux from coming isotropically. Here it's quite old measurements, but it's interesting. It's measurements we made using a TPC on board the Mir station. So it's 20 to 30 years ago. But here, for example, and the dose rate is proportional to the diameter of the cycle. So you can see an increase at high latitude in comparison with here low latitude. And we have what we call the Tau Ceti anomaly. Here, it's because the station is flying at about 400 kilometers. And it's an altitude when there are the lower layer of the radiation or Van Allen belts, as I said before. And the Van Allen and the radiation belts are centralized on the magnetic field axis. So it's not, and the station is rotating regarding the geographical axis. So it's not exactly that they are not the same. So it's why in this region, the station is reaching the lower levels and the lower part of the radiation belts. And if we look at here, it's a dose rate and the function of time. So the station, it takes 1.5 hours for the station to make a complete turn around the Earth. And when, so you can see here the small variation showing the effect of low and high latitude. And here the peaks are occurring when we cross the Tau Atlantic anomaly. So the increase of those can be very important. And here, if you look at the zoom, you can reach more than 1 or 2 millisievert per hour in the Taos Atlantic anomaly. And it takes about 10 minutes to cross this anomaly. Here, it's also interesting regarding metrology because with the TPEC, we can measure the LET, linear energy transfer spectrum. So here, one can see the contribution of different types of particles. For example, here, we can see the contribution of high energy protons. Here, it's for heavy ions. And we can see the fact that when we cross the Taos Atlantic anomaly, we are a more important concentration of protons, and so we can see an increase of the low LET part. And here we had by chance the opportunity to do a measurements during a solar eruption, and you can see the increase of the dose rate at high latitude. And here you can see the particles entering what we call the north here and by the south here, and each injection because the magnetic protection due to magnetic field is less important here. And we can have a dose rate at the same level than in the Taos Atlantic anomaly. Now, it's the courtesy of Günther Reitz, just to finish my presentation. It's an experiment called RAD. It's a mission on March. It's a NASA mission. And it's a mission between November 2011 and August 2012. So RAD, we will see what is the system, was operated during the cruise, the anti-cruise, and also because it's a mission with a landing landing phase, so we have also they made also measurements at the surface of Mars. It was the first time, so, and it's very important in the perspective of manned mission because regarding the human exploration of space, moon missions with human are scheduled by the end of within the next 10 years, and for March it will be around 2040-60. So it's quite close for the moon. So regarding the system, the RAD system, it's a quite complex system with different elements allowing the measurements of the different components, charged particles, ions, electrons, neutrons. So you can see here, I will not go too in details, but you can see here the design of this system. And for example, here you can see the energy range covered by the system for the different components. So you can see that the system is covering quite well all the components of the cosmic radiation we have on the Mars surface. And here it's the spectrum of the different components we have on the Mars surface, and they calculated with a GM4. Here it's for low LET, so you can see the highest abundance is for protons, and here is for helium, for example. So you Here, it's the spectrum for the ILAT components. So you can see that it's completely different than on Earth because the protection and the shielding provided by the atmosphere is very low in comparison to the Earth. So it's why we find also particles, IZ particles, which are present in the primary cosmic radiation. Here, it's also an interesting figure because we can see the contribution to the dose, the absorbed dose, to the equivalent dose for the different components. And here you have the total dose, and here you have the different of the different components. So you can see that here again, even if it's not the most important one, we have a contribution from the IZ particles up to more than 20. Well, this graph is important because we can focus only on the last line. The dose equivalent rate is 1.8 millisievert per day during the cruise, and it's 0.6 on the Mars surface. It's because of the, as I said before, the protection. The protection because we are on the Mars surface. So again, the cosmic radiation is isotrope. We have a protection provided by the fact that we are on the Mars surface. Here it's what the NASA call they have designed a specific mission, and the dose for a reference mission can be calculated, can be estimated thanks to the measurements. So for example, for a mission of 300 days on Mars, the dose here we have a comparison of the dose equivalent and the effective dose. Starting from the dose equivalent with calculation, we can assess the effective dose, which is the dose integrated all organs and using weighting factors regarding the different organs and the radiation. So it's defined, such an effective dose is what we call, is defined by the ICRP, it's International Commission for Radiation Protection. And it's because we have a build-up effect that the effective dose is lower than the effective dose equivalent, than the dose equivalent. And for a mission of 600 days, well, the dose can reach one sievert, the dose equivalent, and corresponding to a 0.6 sievert in terms of effective dose. And just to give an idea, the NASA has fixed the astronaut carrier limit at 600 millisieverts, so 0.6 sievert, which corresponds to 3% excess risk of exposure-induced death for a female 35 years old. So one can see here that such a mission is at the limit, and again, it's a dose estimated without major solar eruption. So in case of huge solar eruption, you can increase the dose by 0.1 up to a few sieverts if we consider the most important dose regarding the, if we look at the last 15 years, you can you can double the dose due to the solar to the solar eruption. So regarding solar eruption, there are specific procedure. For example, there, if you have a detection system, you can go you can quickly go behind the shieldings. But well, again, it's a problem which is considered very seriously for space missions. Okay, now regarding the conclusion. First, the cosmic radiation is a high energy and complex field. At aviation altitude and on Earth, we have a strong attenuation provided by atmosphere and filtering by the magnetic field. The galactic cosmic ray, in particular the secondaries, we have only very sporadic ground level events. In space, we have a small attenuation by the atmosphere or the aircraft shielding, and we have no or very low magnetic field. So in this case, the dose may be due to obviously the galactic part, but also from solar events. The typical exposure level is 0.1 microsievert per hour on Earth, between 1 and 10 microsievert per hour at aviation altitudes, and between 30 and 70 in space. The dosimetry approach in aviation is made mainly by calculation using models for occupational exposure assessment and measurements mainly for their validation. In space, measurements with the appropriate system for personal dosimetry and monitoring is recommended. Regarding the dosimetry and the metrology, as the main contribution to the radiation are neutrons, protons, electrons, positrons, and the heavy ions of high energy. The ISO reference, the ISO reference radiation fields do not fully cover the energy range needed. So we need additional calibration fields, including protons and heavier ion fields. And in this case, non-ISO fields can be used with a traceable technique to measure the particle fluents and define the corresponding ambient dose equivalent by applying the fluence, the right fluence to those conversion factors. We need specific approaches for the characterization and the calibration of instruments and for the particular situation of dosimetry at aviation altitudes, we have defined the specific standards to make the recommendation on dosimetry for exposure to cosmic radiation. Thank you for your attention.